Welcome back to Finnegan's Farm, welcome back to our YouTube channel, and welcome back to our Workshop Wednesday. My name is Paul, and this is our team.
Hi, I'm Sean Keogh, and I'm the apprentice mechanic.
Hi, I'm Mick, and I'm the mechanic.
Hello, I'm Marco, I love to weld. This is Bruce, this is Blake, them is two best students.
Well, what's the story? I'm Kieran Ross, I'm the apprentice mechanic.
Hello, I'm Cottle, and I'm the one that has to make these guys look good.
Don't forget to like, subscribe to the videos, and comment what you want. Just put it in the comments list, and we'll get back to you. So, in for repair today, we have our JCB, the 4220. We have John Deere 7810. We also have the Taylor forklift. We have the Toyota forklift. And we have the Case, the 240 in as well. So we're going to head over to Caleb here and just go through the few issues there with Caleb.
Hi, Caleb. A few issues with the fast track, have we?
Yeah, well, only twos. Well, kind of minor issues. We have an ABS fault and we've no spools on it at the moment.
Right, so you have the plug in there, the computer, just to see the diagnostics on it.
So I was able to use the laptop down there to diagnose the front left wheel sensor. Now, I'm not too sure. This way, I'm just here looking at my parameters if they have one on it, but so I was able to find that straight away with the laptop, and then we've no spools, and again, and all because of one of the mudguard buttons isn't working.
Right.
So it was stopping us from having our spools, so I was able to find all that fairly simple. Now we may have no misapper. So.
And you got the pickup hitch sorted on.
Yeah, so the cable was snapped as well, so we had to put a new cable on it, and the little arm that's off of it is it's very weak, like, so we had to straighten it up because it was getting bent and broken.
Okay. We'll have a sorted there today, hopefully.
Yeah, well, we'll be able to find out whatever parts, if they're older anyways, because I know we'll probably have to get a wheel speed sensor for this.
Yeah.
And after that, then we should be fine.
Okay, so we have the old pickup hitch cable here. Not sure who's responsible for the breakage. I think
John Smith now. I don't think he was lifting up the arms. I think he was trying to open the hitch.
Oh, was he
lifting it, maybe?
Yeah, it's important to lift the arms first,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah, I think it's fairly important.
Yeah, so that's the result. We're blaming him anyway. The switch here on the mudguard then is...
It's just this one here. So I was just able to find that through the diagnostics because it was giving me a fault for the extending. So it was a high fault as it was described as. And when I plug it in and out, it doesn't make any odds. So
we have a dodgy?
Yeah, just a dodgy button.
Dodgy button on there.
So we can get a new button, or I could add a resistor to it either and get the same result.
Right, okay. That's it then, so? Yeah.
So we're over Charlie here in the 7810. Now this is a tractor that we would have bought in, and on most of them 7810, well not them all, but on the majority of them, what happens sometimes is the bracket can go here on the exhaust, and the exhaust can sit down. And as a result, it can sit down on the battery box. Now, the battery box cover, as you can see, was completely gone out, wasn't it, Charlie?
Melted all around here because the heat guard at the bottom was gone completely. So it melted up around here on the battery cover and it broke off then in here. I'd say probably the mudguard.
Yeah, so we have a new battery cover. We have the new heat shield here. That goes around underneath. That could go underneath it now. We'd probably have to take off the stack. Yeah, to get in at it, but anyway.
See how we get on.
Can be dangerous enough, these, and should be probably checked fairly regular because you're sitting down right here on the battery, and we have one instance where it actually burnt the top of the battery. And in there, it can cause a little bit of a fire there if you're not careful. So that's why it's important just to get that heat shield and that back onto it and put a proper battery cover back on it. So you'll be busy at that for the day.
Yeah, done anyway, yeah.
Well, your pipe might have to split it in there, will you?
Yeah, I might have to just look at it. I'll take this off anyway and see how I get on. Then if I can get it out, we'll say I'll get a bit more height there when that comes off.
Right.
I might be able to get over.
We'll leave you that time, all right? Just another little small job we see here. We have a little bit of an oil leak, and it's just the runoff there from the spool valves there. There should be actually a little pipe there that goes from there back down into the bottle here. So need to get that sorted, just leaving the back of it there a little bit dirty. And we do see a little bit of the seal there on the back window has dropped a bit, so probably need to clean that out, a little bit of clear tech 7, just keep that in place. So after that then she's good enough to go then. So in for repair we have our 3-ton Toyota forklift. The lads know that we're going down the yard the other day and a little bit of a speed wobble I think came into it, but Marco will probably explain it here better.
Oh, solar rim broke. But like you see, them old marks. It was cracked before, nearly all the way. Just went.
Yeah, so it obviously went in one spot and it just completely spun it around and
yeah. Racing.
The more, we reckon the more racing with the fastest one anyway. I don't know. Now we'd probably check the other rim here and we have it, but there doesn't seem to be any sign on that at all. If we could check, have a good closer look at it there.
It's not big job, take them few bolts, take wheel off and just...
Well, we have a new rim out for it. If we get it today, we'll stick it on it there. I think we have display it there to put the new rim on it, because these are a semi-solid tyre. As you can see, they have the holes in them there for... gives a little bit of flex on it, on the back wheels there. Now we will check bearings and grease all the back axle there when we have it off. So it's a good chance when we have it in just to go through it there.
Yep. So that was,
that'll be it anyway on the forklift. So we've got the head back here for the tail of forklift. Now this head is of
Yanmar.
It's a Yanmar engine that's in them. They have been noted for having some little bit of problem there with the heads warping on them. So we were told. I don't know. Anyway, Mick is not here. He's away there for a few days. So this is what we've got back. As you can see, it's completely skimmed there. Nice looking job there on it. We'll have to put a new
head gasket on it.
Yeah.
And that's the reason why the head gasket would have went in the first place, is because the head would have warped and
blown. Now, what would cause it to warp? Yeah, Caelan, would that be?
I don't know. I'm not too sure exactly. I'm
afraid to say that, that's fair. We'll have to ask Mick for that one. Yeah. Bit of trivia there for Mick, yeah. And yeah, if you have any comments there, why does the head warp on these Yanmar engines? We're not sure. But anyway, get back into it. You'll probably test it again when he has it in, and hopefully we get the tail lift up and running there in the next day or two. So we're here with the Hubble self-propelled sewing outfit here.
Yeah.
This tractor is stuck on this sewer. It doesn't really move out, so it doesn't kill him.
Well, it does, to go on to the other sewer.
Oh, it's that head, yeah. So the last time you would have seen him, he had the sumo, I think, with it. And then we decided we'd do a little bit of sewing, and he went to plug the pipe in this morning, but...
He's kind of missing the fitting.
He's kind of missing the fitting, yeah. So we don't know. We reckon he took it off this.
For the other one.
For the other one. And then we'll put it back in. It's the return line, I think, on the fan here. Now, we found a fitting. Well, we had a fitting.
Yeah.
Which goes into... It's a flat face fitting, which goes in here. But then we had an issue for going from here to here.
Yeah. So we have a 3/4 inch fitting here. But our pipe's not 3/4. Pipes are M22.
Yeah. So just to explain a little bit more about fittings, it's a nightmare, really, because... these ones here are metric, because it would have came from...
Generally stuff out in the continent.
The continent, from Germany, and the Lemkin is metric. And we want to get onto BSP to go back into the flat face fitting. Yeah. So we'll either have to get an adapter to fit it, or send Hubble's out and get the fucking one that he took off in the first place.
Which I say is the most likely one.
It's probably the most likely one, isn't it? Yeah. So we need to just get that fitting started here. We have a little bit of IC rape to sew there, and just to... get it finished off there. It'll be the last bit of sewing it'll do, but yeah, just these fittings there. We're mostly BSP, 1/4 inch, 3/8, 1/2 inch, and 3/4 inch is what we would use. But a lot of metric fittings here as well, on some of the, as we say, some of the stuff that's overseas. That's 20. How do you measure that actually?
So what I was able to do, put my calipers onto the inside, and I can measure so the inside of the treads here. Now, my digital one's not just walking too well. When he is 20.5 millimeters. Now, I have a chart on my phone, which I've saved as a contact here, which is always a very handy thing to do. So I can search hydraulic fittings, go into my messages, and I have all the fittings here. Now, I have the inner diameters here, which is, say, M22, and the inner diameter is 20.5 millimeters. So that's why I found out that was an M22 thread.
Thread, yeah.
And I do the same thing for the outer threads on the BSP, but I just generally know to see anyway which size is which.
Yeah, you will generally know to see, but for a lot of people just might know and they'll be trying to say, well, that's 3/4.
Yeah, like I wouldn't be overly familiar with metric, that's why I had to do that, just to confirm it, so we can get the right one.
Right, but, so we need to get that started anyway and get back on the road.
Yeah.
So we finally found the fitting of the 240. What's the story, Darren? Where did you hide it?
Oh, I don't know. I'm going to blame Kev on this one.
You're going to blame Kev on this? He put it away.
The trouble of getting demo machines and they're not right, and you have to get fittings on.
And
them,
then he came with the sumo, wasn't even right. No fittings on it.
Had to rob them off the Lemkin.
Yeah.
And then the sumo went, and then we went to go use the Lemkin and no fittings.
Yeah. So it's a bit of a saga. Anyway, we have it here. What about you fitting on it here?
Yeah, it was, the other one was sweeping a bit around it and looking 5 or 6 year old.
So. Right, so we tighten this up and hopefully now this fits.
Well, if it doesn't, I'm going home.
This is the metric bit.
There's enough fucking on.
Tighten it up there.
Right.
Right. Head to the factory. Yes. So, I hope that this fits now.
Hope so. If it doesn't, I'm going home.
Look at that.
Finally. Just as well as having 1,000 acres to sow.
Yeah. What's this for your fan? Returning a fan?
Return, yeah, for the fan.
Right. Want something to hold that?
Right. That's it.
So that's it for this week's Workshop Wednesday. We hope you all enjoyed the videos. Don't forget to like, subscribe to the videos. If you have a comment there, put it in the comments list and we will get back to you. So from everyone here at Finnegan's Farm, we'll talk to you next Wednesday.